Even as we continue to look into God's word, I want to tell you, God is in the business of seeking and raising up the Gideons. And I believe God is not only knocking the doors of your home, but God is knocking the doors of your heart right now. You could be in a cave, you could be in a valley, but God is going to raise you up. God is going to lift you up, and God is going to empower you. You could be there hiding like a Gideon, maybe. You could be hiding like Gideon there in failure and in fear. Or you could be like Peter in the boat, who heard the word of Jesus, the voice of Jesus, and dared to say, "Lord, if it is you, let me come." I don't know whether you belong to the Peter category or the Gideon category. Either of it, God is going to raise you up to make you what He made you to be, and that is an overcomer. So this morning time, even as I'm going to start preaching the word of God into your lives, I want to bring you back to what we've been learning. The focus of our attention, not only because of the COVID situation that is there, but I want to take you further. Today I want to take you into another facet of faith. Faith is a shield that protects us. Faith is the clinching factor that gives us a victory, which we saw in detail last Friday morning. But today, I want to bring the word into your life saying that faith not only gives me victory, but faith also gives me entry. Now, if faith gives me the victory against the battles, and faith gives me the entry, the question comes, entry into what? Wonderful. Let's go into God's word today. But before I read the scripture, I want to one more time bring the focus of our attention to what is there in my heart. I think all our efforts today and forever must be never to downgrade our life, a vision, ministry, or a dream to match the reality of life. But I would rather spend the time in upgrading our faith to match the plans, the purposes, and the destiny of God. If there has been a kind of a setback that happens, I will not going to say, okay, let me downgrade my vision. Okay, let me downgrade my standard of living. Let me downgrade this. No. I would rather spend that time in upgrading now, not my life, upgrading my faith. And my faith is upgraded, automatically my life and everything that pertains to it is upgraded, because it is faith that grants me the victory. So, even as we've been talking about faith so much, because that is what Jesus talked about. In fact, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, the Bible says, "But without faith, it is impossible to please God." That means the inverse of it is, if you and I want to please God, we got to go to Him by faith, because we need to know that God is there, He is existing, and He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Isn't that amazing? It's not our works that is going to please Him. It is nothing what we do pleases Him. He is already pleased with us. And if you and I will have a simple faith in this Almighty God, His heart rejoices, saying, "Hey, look there, my child is pleased in me." Now, we saw at length last week, 1 John 5:4. It is faith that gives us the victory. But I want to take you into another scripture, Romans chapter 5 and verse 2, please. In Romans chapter 5, verse 2, Paul the Apostle expounding on grace. You know, he's at length talking about grace. And he says, we have been justified by faith in verse 1. But in verse 2, he says, "Through Him we have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God." I want you to understand this. Let me kind of paraphrase this so that you and I will understand it better. Paul is saying in chapter 5, verse 2, faith gives me the access into the grace. Let me simplify it. He's simply saying, by faith, I gain entry into the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, faith, according to 1 John 5:4, gave me the victory. But according to Romans 5:2, the Bible says, faith is the entry into the grace of Jesus Christ. Now, for you and I to understand this, you know why? The whole effort is that you and I will upgrade our faith to everything that Jesus Christ has prepared for you and I. Now, grace is available for all. It is available for free for all. But, you know, you and I, just because grace is available, cannot anyhow and enter into this grace. There is only one door that gives you the entry into this grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that is our faith. Let's go a little more time in trying to understand what is this grace. How did it come into our lives? If we read the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 17, the Apostle John writing, he says, the law, or the commandment that only brought the knowledge of sin into our lives, was given through Moses. But grace and truth that saved us came through Jesus Christ. Now I want you to understand, there is a Lord Jesus Christ. The law came through Moses, but when Jesus came, he came carrying the grace of God, and he came carrying the truth of the Almighty God. Now, if grace came through the Lord Jesus Christ, what did grace bring into my life? Don't forget that scripture. In Romans chapter 5, verse 2, we said, faith in me gives me the access, gives me the entry into the grace of the Lord Jesus. I want to ask another question here. If grace came through Jesus and my faith takes me into the grace, what are the riches available in this grace? Because when you read Ephesians chapter 2, verse 7, Paul the apostle writes there that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding or immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Now, grace came through Jesus, but Paul is saying this grace carries immeasurable riches in itself when it came through the Lord Jesus Christ. So if I enter into that grace, what am I going to experience in my life, which is by grace? Now, when you and I are talking about grace, when you say anything is by the grace of God from heaven, then everything is only by faith from the earth. If only that grace from heaven meets with faith from the earth, what results is salvation. What results is the life of God that is made available in Jesus Christ. Now, Paul the Apostle talks about the riches of grace. Let me quickly run you through, okay? Now, number one, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5 again, it says, we've been forgiven by grace. Number two, in Romans chapter 3, verse 24, I'm going to kind of rush through. The Bible says, we've been justified by grace. In Romans 5, 17, the Bible says, we are made righteous by grace. Remember, forgiveness is in grace. Justification, that means just as if you have never sinned, is in grace. Righteousness means you stand before a holy God without a sense of fear, guilt, or condemnation, because the price and the punishment was paid in Christ Jesus. You stand with boldness. That's the gift of righteousness. It's there in grace, and this grace is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only there, in Galatians 1:15, Paul says, I've been called by grace. You know, this is a great calling. Every one of you are listening to me. God has a great call upon your life. And many of us feel, hey, you know what? I'm unqualified for this. You know, I don't have the qualifications. No. It is God doesn't call the qualified, he calls the unqualified by his grace and then qualifies them. Grace qualifies you for the call of God. Then, not only the calling, Titus 2:11, Paul says, I am taught by grace. Now, this is something amazing. You know, teaching is an ability. Again, that I believe is a gift of God. But having the ability to learn, that's the aptitude to learn, the spiritual revelations comes by the grace, and that grace is in Jesus, and the access and the entry is by faith. Now let's keep pace with me. To do this ministry, what we've been called for, gifts of the Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians 12:1, again by grace. 2 Corinthians 8:9, Paul says, this is the grace of the Lord Jesus. Though he was rich, yet he became poor, that through his poverty I might be made rich. Providence comes again by grace. And then giving is also a grace. If you read in 2 Corinthians 9:8, we saw that. And then I want to bring you to this final thing. In my list, it's not the exhaustive list. According to Galatians 3:13 and 14, by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, you and I have become partakers in the blessings of Abraham. Man, I tell you, it is so, so rich. All these exceeding riches are there in grace. And finally, the top, the cream on it is that we are partakers of the blessings of Abraham. When you say we are the partakers of the blessings of Abraham, what do you and I understand? Is it only a blessing on the earth that we receive? Is it talking about a better life status? Probably. Is it about a better car and better health? Probably. Because God delights when you and I prosper. But our life is not made only for health and wealth. You and I have been saved because God has a great, great plan into our lives. When God called Abraham, he gave him a blessing and said, Abraham, I will bless you. I will make you a blessing. That's wonderful. That means the destiny of your life and my life, when we enter into the Abrahamic blessing in Christ Jesus, means that not only we are made to receive a blessing, we've been made to be a blessing. Let's not stop there. But God said, Abraham, I'll not only make you a blessing, I'll make you a blessing in the nations of the world. That's your destiny. And you know what you and I are trying to do today? We're trying to upgrade our faith, not only to receive forgiveness and justification and righteousness and calling and the ability to learn, but we are upgrading our faith. No matter what the situation around, you and I must be a blessing into the nations of the world. That's your inheritance that has been there in grace. It is there in grace. It's like, you know, it is all there in an island of grace. There is forgiveness, there is justification, there is righteousness, but you are far away and there is a huge water body there. You're unable to go, but then suddenly one bridge comes there. And if you will use that bridge, you enter into that island of grace, you find forgiveness, you find justification, you find righteousness, you find calling, you find providence, you are becoming a giver and you become a blessing into the nation. And you say, what is this bridge? And that one bridge is called by faith. By faith, we have access into this grace. This grace is in Christ Jesus. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that enough reason for you and I to spend time intentionally as an individual, as a family, as a church saying, you know what, I want to upgrade my faith. Now comes the question. Many of us know this here in our coconut, but it needs to go 1 foot down into the heart, because and then when it becomes a matter of the heart, it's not a mere knowledge, it becomes an obedience to what God tells us to do, which will increase our faith. Romans chapter 10 verse 17, I will love it in the Passion Translation. If we can read it, it says, It is by the word of God when it comes inside, the faith in the inside of us starts becoming greater and greater. You know, Romans chapter 10 verse 17 says, by the word of God, faith rises up in our heart. Now, if all of this is there in the grace and I have an access only by faith, why am I going to waste my time and energy in anything other than building that bridge to reach that island of grace where all that I would ever need is there in that grace which Jesus Christ brought into our lives? It would only take a fool not to build that bridge. It'll take only a fool not to cross over that bridge of faith into everything that God has in store for us. Number one, how do I build that bridge of faith? Is by feeding myself intentionally, feeding myself consistently, feeding myself daily with the word of the Almighty God. If the word comes, faith rises. When the word of God comes, faith rises. But let me take you further. I can spend a lot of time in it, but I want to take you into something that God has put into my heart. I want to talk to you about a man of God from the Bible. But let me take you. What are the ingredients needed to build this bridge? Number two. On the one side, it is God's word. On the other side, it is praying in the spirit. When we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, Paul the apostle writing there says, but my beloved, pray in the Holy Spirit. And that, he says, builds yourself. Rather, it builds your faith. Even when you read the epistle of Jude, the Bible says, contend for your faith by praying in the Holy Spirit. That means I understand that when I fill myself with the word of God, it helps me to build that bridge of faith. And when I'm praying in the Holy Spirit, in that unknown language, there are some people who do not believe in it. Yet some others, they have the gift of the praying in tongues. The only time they pray is maybe in a church service or maybe when the worship is going on for a few seconds. But I want to learn from the word of God. I want to learn from Paul the apostle writing to the Corinthians saying, guys, you're praying too much in tongues. He says at one place, I pray in tongues, unknown tongues, more than all of you put together. Wow, that's a very tall order. But you know, some people, they don't believe in this praying in tongues. One of the persons came to me and said, I don't believe in praying in tongues. I told him, I believe in it, not because you don't believe. I believe in it, not because of any other reason. I believe in it because it is written in the word of God. And then he got angry on me. He said, Srini, you know what? I will not listen to you because you pray in tongues. And I will not even read any book that believes in unknown tongues. Then I told him, we all were sitting together. I had a holy Bible in his hand. I snatched the Bible from his hand. And I said, never ever read the Bible in your life again. He said, how dare you tell that? I said, sir, when you read the New Testament, it was written by people who spoke in tongues. Paul the apostle. Then you should never read Corinthians. You should never read Galatians or Ephesians. He was looking at me with no answer. You know, doctrine is not man-made. I think what we need is a simple faith in the word of God. I want to encourage you today. On a daily, consistent, regular basis, why don't you start praying in unknown tongues? Now, you don't need to shout in tongues like some people do. The moment you say pray in unknown tongues, they loudly. No. God did not say shout in tongues. Bible says speak in unknown tongues. You can speak to yourself, but you know, make a kind of a discipline. This many moment, I'm going to put a stopwatch and tell Siri, we all have smartphones, right? Say, Siri, set a timer for 20 minutes. Walk up and down, keep praying in tongues. Walk up and down, keep praying in tongues. But you say, what to do with my mind? You already have filled with the word of God. First step, Take that word to your mind. Be meditating. Don't let it go run here and there. It'll run like a wild dog. Meditate the word of God. Speak in tongues. Meditate the word of God. Speak in tongues. You know what is going to happen? Mind will be renewed by the word of God. And the spirit will be strengthened in faith because you're praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. The bridge of faith becomes stronger. Then another facet is you need to have prayer and fasting. Fasting. Yeah, I said it right. Fasting. You know, Matthew chapter 17, Jesus talking about when he came down from the mount where he was transfigured, and there he saw the Father and the Son, and the disciples could not cast out the demon. Jesus comes and rebukes them and says, "Hey, you of unbelief." And then the Bible says he cast it out then in private when the disciples come and said, "Why we could not?" He says, "Because of your unbelief." Problem. But then Jesus said, "But this kind does not go but by prayer and fasting." I just want to leave you there saying, if Jesus said this kind, there is a that kind. And that kind is mediocre. Small things. But if you want the highest and the best, which I'm going to take you as I progress in my sermon, you need to be a person where prayer and fasting will be a weekly discipline of your life. No compromise on that. I have met many people in the Middle East. There are going to be new definitions of fasting. For many people, fasting is only delayed eating. They eat breakfast. They will delay it till 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock. They'll have a heavy lunch and then I'll have dinner also. At the end of the day, you count it, 3 meals are over. What's fasting? Fasting is to abstain. Because in the place of food, you want to give that place to God. Your flesh is mortified, unbelief is mortified, and what emerges is Christ-likeness and faith to do the impossible. Amen. And then number four, not only fasting, you need to be speaking or confessing the word of God. Now I'm not talking about preaching, okay? These are the ways and means we can build our faith. Remember, we're not people of religion. We are a people of faith in Jesus. That's why the Lord said, "When I come back, when I return, will I find faith?" I want Jesus to find faith in me when he comes back. I want Jesus to find faith in our church, in the lives of everyone who's listening to me. Because when he comes, he wants to see you and he wants to see faith in you. And that faith will please God. So you and I need to have a habit of speaking the word of God. You know, speak the word to the mountain. It will move and fall into the sea. Speak the word of God into the valley. When Ezekiel went into the valley of dry bones, he spoke the word. And when he spoke the word, the bones started moving. Don't talk about your problem. Don't talk about unbelieving things. Don't talk about defeat. Speak the word of God. But mind you here, when you are speaking, you're not speaking the result. You're speaking the word of God. There is a difference here. We're not creating a positive atmosphere by saying positive things and not saying negative things. No, no, no. This is not a battle between the positive and the negative. This is between the word of God and the words of death. In the book of Proverbs, the Bible says, life and death is in the power of our tongue. When I say the word of God, God confirms, not my word, the word of God I have spoken with signs, wonders, and different miracles following. I speak, he confirms. You speak, he will confirm. Speak to the mountain, speak into the valley, and number three, very importantly, speak to yourself. I tell you, you have no bigger problem in your life than yourself. It holds good for me too. I am my biggest problem. If I am able to speak the word into my life, what happens is I am feeding my soul with the word of God. And what will rise is unbelief gets edged out and faith rises up. And that faith gives me the entry into the grace which is in Jesus. And in grace is the richest of grace that I find. God wants you to be strong in faith. But now I wanted to give you an example as I'm going to challenge you today. You know why I want to challenge you? I challenge myself. I don't want to be a mere hearer of God's word. I want to be a doer of God's word. We've been hearing about faith for almost 3 weeks now. We talked about how faith gives us the victory. We heard about how faith is a shield, protects us from every darts of the devil. We saw now how faith gives me the entry. So let's imagine that we are sitting here building our faith. What are we going to achieve? For some people, faith in them has taken them into heaven. I don't want to end up that. I'm sure it is by faith and by the grace of Jesus, I am born again. I am forgiven. But I don't want to end my salvation, because if you and I are going to say salvation was meant only for forgiveness, I somehow feel we have downgraded the entire gamut of salvation. When salvation Jesus brought into your life and my life, he not only brought forgiveness, not only brought justification and righteousness, he brought back the destiny of God into your life. That's why you are designed and destined to be a blessing into the nations of the world. But you need that faith to rise up within you. I want to take a few minutes and talk to you about one of my favorite characters in the Bible. A very simple man, wouldn't see his name too much. His name is Caleb. Caleb figures in Numbers chapter 13. He was one among the 12 leaders from 12 tribes, and Caleb belonged to the tribe of Judah, who was sent to spy the land and bring back a report. Is it as God said it be? So he went along with the 12. He and Joshua were a group because they were people of faith. But there was the other 10 who were unbelieving people. I don't want to go into the details of that. I want to keep my focus of attention on Caleb today. And the Bible says in verse 28 of Numbers 13, they brought until verse 27, their report was very good. But verse 28, if we will read, now this is the voice of the 10 people, the unbelieving guys. They said, however, the people who dwell in the land are strong, cities are fortified, very large, and besides, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Now in my King James, we will not read it. It says, instead of that word besides, it says, moreover, as though all this was not enough, we saw the sons of Anak there. I want you to underline. If you're taking down notes, good thing. Highlight it. Underline it. Sons of Anak. That means they said, we have the Amalekites, we have the Jebusites, we have the Canaanites. Moreover, we have the sons of Anak or the Anakims there. And they said, because of those Anakims, it was like Anakims were the last straw on the camel back of their unbelief that broke their faith and made it absolutely impossible for them to gain an entry into the promised land. Remember, faith gives you an entry. But then Caleb in verse 30, Bible says, he quietened the people and said, hey guys, keep quiet. What are you talking, man? Let us go at once. We will occupy it. We will possess it because we are more than able to overcome, whether it is an Amalekite, a Canaanite, or even the Anakims, because God is there and we are a people of faith. But lo and behold, it's a very tragic story. The problem is, in many times, it's not the people of faith who triumph. It's people with influence who triumph. And here, these 10 people who never had any faith, these 10 people who were in unbelief, they kind of prevailed over and they did not enter. Now just imagine. Caleb, a person of faith, is going around in the wilderness for 45 years. And he is with almost 2 million people, and most of them are unbelieving people. But watch it. In this 45 years, what has happened is an entire generation died. But before they died, they left behind a legacy. What was their legacy? They were perpetual murmurers. They were perpetually complaining against anything and everything that happened. They were discontented. They were disobeying. They were always rebelling, fighting among themselves, to a point of rebellion where they took stones many times to stone their chief pastor Moses also. They prevailed upon the associate pastor Aaron to make a god and said, come on, let's go back to Egypt. And in the midst of this rebellion, in the midst of the murmuring, in the midst of this backbiting, in the midst of this disobedience, discontentment, Caleb is also journeying. Hallelujah. You know, many a times you say, I would have had faith, but these 10 people influenced me. 2 million people versus 2 people, Joshua and Caleb. You and I have a choice today. Look at the world outside. It is crumbling in unbelief. Look at the world, even the church outside. We are talking about self-help, self-help. I tell you, church is not a place of self-help. Church is not a self-made thing. It is a place where we receive God help. It is a place where we are God made by our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Just imagine. In the midst of all the murmur, in the midst of all the backbiting, in the midst not getting caught up with that wave of rebellion, Caleb stayed back. And you know what he did? He spent time building his faith. Wow. I want to pause and I want to learn from Caleb. There are 10 people in the church sitting and murmuring, but I want to step aside and do what? Fill myself with the word of God. You know why? I have a destiny to enter. And the only way I can enter into my destiny is not when I am with the rebellious. It is not when I am with the discontent. It is not when I am with the murmuring. It is not when I am with the complaining people. It is when I am with the word of the Almighty God. When I enter, it is not only for myself. I enter to be a blessing into the nations of the world. And here is Caleb. In the midst of all of this, he kept his faith. And I want to kind of leap forward from Numbers 13 to Joshua chapter 14. I want to challenge you today. People of faith. Now 45 years have gone by. From 40-year-old Caleb, he's become an 85-year-old man. In verse 7, he comes to Joshua and he says, hey, Joshua. Joshua says, hey, my old friend, how are you, man? You and I are the only guys who survived this onslaught of murmur and rebellion and everything. Only you and I are there. They gave a high five to each other. Joshua said, what can I do for you? Caleb says, chapter 14, verse 7 of Joshua, he says, I was 40 years old when Moses sent me to spy the land that we came. And he says, when I went there, I brought the word as it was in my heart. I'm reading from the King James Version. I love this. You know, he says, Joshua, where you remember those days 45 years ago? He says, yeah, I clearly remember it, man. Because of that day, we went into wilderness for 45 years and we are here again in the promised land. He says, Joshua, remember. The day when I brought that word that we are more than able to do it, it was not my word. I brought the word because the word of God was in my heart. And that word brought the faith, and that's why I made that declaration of faith. But that was 45 years ago. And then in verse 8 he says, not only did I bring the word that was in my heart, but I completely or fully followed the Lord. I love this. Faith is not only declaring, moving the mountain, raising people from the valley. Faith in our lives is not a result of our efforts. Faith in our life is a direct result of total surrender to the will of the Almighty God. When you see people of faith doing great things, remember, in their private closet, there has been an absolute surrender to the will of the Almighty God. Without the surrender, I tell you, it will not happen. In the life of Caleb, it happened. You know why? He had completely surrendered, fully following the Lord. But you may say, but Pastor, it was 45 years back. Yeah, I'm bringing you there. Then in verse 11, he's telling a testimony of the today. We thought it was only about yesterday. Let's come to the today. 45 years have gone by. And Caleb is saying, you know what, Joshua? And today, it is in Joshua chapter 14, verse 8. In Joshua chapter 14, verse 8, he says, verse 11, I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was at that time, even so is my strength for war, both to go out and come in. Man, I want to salute this man. Can you imagine? Young people who are listening to me, can you imagine? 45 years later, he comes and says, I have kept my strength not to walk without a support as an 85-year-old man. Today, when you see an 85-year-old walking without a support or a crutch or a walker, you say, wow, he is strong. But Caleb is saying, hey, Joshua, I'm not talking about that. He says, I'm strong for war. I want to sit at the feet of Caleb and said, how? He will say, you know what, Srini? When everybody around were murmuring, complaining, rebelling, I spent my time in building my faith with the word of the Almighty God. I said, Caleb, I want to be like you. He says, you need to, in the midst of this chaotic world, you need to concentrate on your faith. Only faith makes you strong. I said, wonderful. So now you have this faith, Caleb. Joshua says, okay, what do you want me to do? Shall I give you a green pasture right next to a brook so that you can enjoy your retired life? Anyway, you're my friend. What I give stays. I can use my influence here. Caleb says, no. I'm a man of faith. I don't choose the easy path. He says, I am a man of faith. I've upgraded my faith. Therefore, I want to take that same Anakims. You remember those Anakims? Oh, how can I forget them? They were the giants. They were the tall guys. They are the guys, the last straw that broke the faith of these Israelites. He says, that mountain I want. I don't want to take the Amalekites. I don't want to take the Canaanites. I leave it for the others. But I want that mountain. Joshua must have said, are you sure, Caleb? That's the mountain of the giants. He says, exactly. But you know what really challenges me? It is not that God spoke to Caleb and said, hey, Caleb, thus saith the Lord, go take this mountain. No, it never records at least. You know, there are two words I am a little extra cautious about. The Lord led me, very dangerous. I believe in it. The Lord leads us. But in the name of this, the Lord led me, so much happens. Number two. If God leads me, I will go. If God leads me, I will give. If God leads me, I will fast. I somehow am not comfortable with that. A man of faith, Caleb. 45 years ago, these were the giants that took us down. He says, I want to take the giant again. Did God lead you? My faith is leading me. My faith in God is leading me. Somebody asked a man of God, can you pray and tell me, should I go for evangelism? Should I go for missions? Should I go? And the man of God said, 2,000 years ago, God told you to go. Why do you need to pray again? Just go. Faith gives us the victory, but faith gives us the entry into the promised land, into your destiny. And a man of faith, Caleb, you know what he did? He rose up and he took that mountain. And these days I've been studying a lot on faith. And I've been challenging myself, especially in regards to missions. I said, if I am claiming the faith that Caleb had, I'm not going to settle for anything little. I want to see the unseen. I want to hear the unheard. And I want to do the undone because of my faith in God. I want to take the anathemas. God is with me. What about you? As I was praying, God has been putting certain things into my heart about missions, which I will share. I'm not looking at merely doing a church here and a church there. I am praying, God, if at all we go into a district or a region, can I believe you for saturation church planting? That means you go into a place, 5,000 villages without churches. But in 5 years, there will not be a single village without a church. It has never been done. It is impossible. Hey, that's what faith can do. Amen. Let us take the mountain. Let us take the giants, because the faith in us is able to do the impossible. I want to urge every one of you, be intentional, be disciplined, regular, feed your faith, grow your faith, and then come back like Caleb and say, you know what? I want that mountain. Give me that mountain. And then the Bible says, Caleb took the mountain. You and I are able because of our faith in Jesus. Faith gives us the victory. Faith gives us the entry into the destiny of God. You're made to be blessed. You're made to be a blessing into the nations of the world. Shall we pray together? When God challenged me, I lost sleep in the nights. I've been waking up pretty early these days. Well early, well much early. And I've been challenging myself. Overwhelmed by what Caleb did. And I want to say, God, I want to go into those unreached areas. I'm challenged by a man of God. I forget his name. It says before he went into that region, there was not a Christian. But when he died, there was not even a single person who was not a Christian. That's the legacy we need to leave behind. God has a plan in your life. God has a purpose in your life. Rise up. Let faith rise within you. By faith, it is possible. Shall we pray together? Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray that each and every one of us here, we will not be a people of religion, but we will be a people of faith. And in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray that everyone, with the help of the Holy Spirit, will be people who will fill their lives with the Word of God. Will be people who will, Lord, pray in the unknown tongues. And if there's anybody who's not baptized in the Holy Spirit, touch them right now. Let the gift of tongues come in the name of the Lord Jesus. And I pray that we will be a people who will always fast and pray and confess and prophesy the word. And I pray as faith rises in the lives of the people, they will not sit quiet, but like Caleb, they will go after the mountains instead of hiding under that religious phrase, if the Lord leads me. Deliver us from that, we pray. Deliver us, O God, so that we will rise up, take the unreached for your sake, and be a blessing into the nations of the world. I pray for your hand to you upon every family. May your glory and your grace rest and abide upon them. In Jesus' name we pray. And every person of faith said aloud, amen, amen. Put it. God bless you and have a wonderful week ahead of you. See you next week.